So there will never be a such thing as God has been. I know we may think that, and that's a nice little series to have, but God never baits us. He draws us. So it can only be devil's bait. And when you find out what bait is, then you're going to realize God has never baited you. He's only drawn you to him. Bait is something that cannot be used unless there is something in you that will receive it. So you're going to find out this morning that your troubles and your heartache and your disappointment and all of your temptation that you struggle with is because of something in you. I'm going to disrupt the enemy's pseudo power. He cannot do anything to you, against you, that you don't already have in you for him to work with. I'm not making this up. So let us turn to James, the first chapter. I know some people, their feelings are hurt. And we're going to patch them up today. After we say, oh well. But we're going to patch them up. There's nothing like eye-opening information to help you change. And in James, the first chapter, and the 14th and the 15th verse, it reads, let me start at the 13th verse. It says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. So that disqualifies God. He's not doing any of your tempting. For God cannot be tempted with evil. Neither tempted he any man. And I'm going to digress a little bit. He can do it because he knows what's in you. So he doesn't have to guess. Yeah. The enemy guesses what's in you, and he finds out by your response.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
14 says, but every man is tempted. Listen closely, because I think I just alluded to this. Every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. Own lust and enticed. His own lust. And when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. So I'm going to give you a progress report on how things happen to you and how you receive information so that you can understand what's going on. Because people say the devil made me do things, and I wouldn't have ever done that had they not pushed me to do something. And we have all kinds of excuses, but I want you to know that you would not do anything and be tempted with anything if it were not in you at first. You are influenced by three receptacles. You're influenced by thought from the outside in. You're influenced by thought from your brain. And you're influenced by thought from the Holy Ghost. So the Spirit of God can give you a thought. You can give yourself a thought. And then thoughts can be put in your mind by the enemy. And what you have to do in this life is discern which thought is coming from whom. Once you master that, you'll realize how much power you have. You'll realize how much power you have. How you know the Spirit of God has given you a thought, it is congruent with the Word of God. If you are unsaved and you have a conscience, that's why God placed a conscience in everyone born, so that if they don't have the word, there is something in them that triggers them to say, this isn't right. The problem is humans override that, and they override it so much that it becomes dull. And their conscience does not give them an alert anymore. Or it's so faint they don't hear. But people are born with a conscience. And then you have the capability of generating a thought, because God gave you a brain. And your thoughts don't always coincide with the word of God, but they are humanistic and they're moral. And God doesn't have to give you that thought. He gave you moral concepts or moral mores. But there are norms in which you would use to gender or manifest a thought. Then there are thoughts from the enemy. And most of us are influenced by thoughts from the enemy because there's something in us that is contrary to the will of God. So when you get a thought and it's not written in the word of God, and your conscience is seared or dull because you have rejected the alert so many times, you have something in you that the enemy can work with. Amen. Everyone is not tempted by the same things. So don't believe that every man wants to have sex with you because they speak to you. Just because a man says, good morning, how are you today, he's not flirting. Amen. Women. He's not sexually harassing you because he says you look nice. Amen. There is something nasty in you. To believe that the man that was made in God's image and after his likeness, all of them are fallen. And all of them have a demented way of thinking. I do not believe that. There may be a lot, but I don't believe all. But we have become so demented in our society that men cannot even compliment women any longer. Men, just because a woman smiles at you does not mean she will go home with you. Women are afraid to be nice to men because that is a signal for them to advance. And that's not what that means. He cannot open the door for anyone. He can't do anything. He can't even fix your tire because after that you think you have to go home with him. Thought. Thought. Principalities in which we live in, and thought is dropped on us, and because a thought comes, we think it's our thought. But if it's contrary to the will of God, it is not a thought you should keep and nourish. You can resist that thought. But because the lust is in you, you entertain the thought. And that's why Jesus said, if you think, looking at a woman, and think to lust after her, you already went to bed. I know this is not a popular subject, and I didn't choose it. We're talking about the devil's brain. You should not act on everything you feel and you think. But he's drawn away by his own lust and enticed. Satan traps and hooks you. Jesus draws you. Satan wants to bring you down with thoughts. So when thoughts come to you that are not edifying to your body and soul, you should reject it. You have to actually clear your environment of contamination. Some people don't know how to live clean. They watch everything on TV that is trendy. They listen to everything around them. They allow people with nasty mouths to keep company with them. They don't clean up their environment, and your mind is like a sponge. You are some of the most intricate and some most the most complex machinery that God has ever created. And your mind can absorb information and you don't even realize it's storing it. But you surround yourself by filthy people and filthy atmospheres and non-productive content, and then you want God to rescue you when you start acting a certain way. I'm still talking about the devil's bait. So the devil's not going to come to you and make himself known to you in a way where you will resist him. He's going to come to you in a way, first of all, that is compelling to you so that you will be tricked into believing that what you have heard or thought is God. Bait is food or substance to bait or hook or trap something. That's what bait is. It's never to nourish, it's never to make better, it's never to make alive, it's never to do that. It is to deceive you into doing something that is not real. So what the enemy will do, he will bait you with kindness if you're looking for kindness and has not found kindness. But the kindness is pseudo kindness or false kindness because it's not love. And God draws through love. Sometimes we allow images of the enemy to allow images to distort us. And I don't want to get ahead of myself. But God is saying, you need him to be your Google images, not the enemy. I work on projects all the time, and I wait until the images flashed in my mind to start working on the project. Because I know if I can do that image that was flashed in my mind, I can complete the project. Some of us allow thoughts to come and believe that it is the Lord. But there are things in us that need to change. You cannot blame anyone for your failures. You cannot blame anyone for your temptations. You cannot blame anyone for the things that's in you that's causing you to fail. It's in you. So, Elder, what can I do about it? We're going to talk about that a little bit later. There is the lust of the flesh. There is the lust of the eye. And there is the pride of life. There is the lust of the flesh, there is the lust of the eye, and there is the pride of life. Lust of the flesh can be anything from I have to look a certain way to I have to smell a certain way. You say, well, Ellen, we need to have nice fragrance and smell good and things like that, but your motive is wrong. Your motives are wrong. And what happens is the enemy will allow you to freshen yourself up. And I'm talking about spiritually now. He'll allow you to freshen yourself up. You'll come to the altar. You'll get purged of everything that you ask the Lord to purge you from. That you ask the Lord to purge you from. And then you go out. And your ground is clean. And your ground is clear. So some of us have walked away from drugs, walked away from smoking marijuana, but we're around people who smoke. We get cleaned up before the altar of God, whether it's here or at our houses, but we still hang around people who do that same thing. knowing that that tendency is there, that propensity is still there. God not only cleans you up, he uproots that lust that's in you. God not only cleans you up, he takes the propensity toward that thing away from you so that you won't even lust after it, nor will you be tempted by the lust of it.
Amen. Amen.
He draws with love. He draws with love. He draws with meekness. He does not fool you into believing something that is not. Humans are attracted to things that they either want very badly or can't have. When you think you want, when you think you can get something, when you think you can get something, it's not a challenge. It's not a challenge. But we are taught as a nation and as a people certain things that are actually not good for us. And I'll give you an example. It's always been said that the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. And most often, you can get a man's attention by cooking a good meal. But I'm going to drop a bombshell on you females so you can understand what you're dealing with. Most men are not emotional. So I want you to listen. You're emotional. And if you make them feel something, another woman can make them feel something too. Your goal, men, close your ears. Your goal should be to influence the way he thinks, not the way he feels. Men, close your ears. I'm giving secrets now. But because of the lust of the flesh, we think we can get people by changing how they feel about us. And a man will change how he feels about you if you make him think different about you.
Amen.
His rationale kicks in. Is she going to be good for me? Will she be a good partner? Will she be good to my children? That's what he should be. Will she be there for me when no one else is? Not will she make me feel good. Because any woman can make him feel good. I want them to see you. Let's flip that over. We think it's wonderful to make God feel good. When we praise and worship. But God sees beyond that. And he said, if you love me, not if you love me, you'll worship me. Not if you love me, you'll praise me. Because the rocks will cry out if you don't. But rocks don't keep his commandments. Rocks cannot keep his word. We have to keep his word. So God is not impressed or have feelings for us. His love drove him to the cross. He did something for us. He did something, not felt something. But we are satisfied with how the enemy operates because if he makes us feel good, it's all good. And what we have to do is, if it feels too good, it may not be good. Because what's after that? How many people, don't raise your hands, how many people are divorced today? And you felt good when you met your husband or wife. So how long does it last? But did you live and build a life together? Did you go beyond how it felt and say, Lord, I'm going to work with this. I'm going to disrupt and disregard what people are saying. I'm going to disregard what I'm feeling. I'm going to disregard the devil's bait. I'm going to disregard what the world is saying. I'm going to disregard and we're going to make this happen. The enemy cannot be the boss of you. He cannot be the boss of you. You have to allow God to draw you. If you allow God to seal you, shape you, mold you, comfort you, do all the necessary things that is needed in you, those lusts, those imperfections, those things that's not like him would come out of you. There would be no temptation. There are people who are living holy. There are people who are living saved. There are people who overcome. There are people who are not lured by the devil's bait. There are people who do not bite because there's nothing in there that's attracting them. Everybody's not moved and lured by the same thing. And some people are living glory to glory. There are people who are not weak. Because they've allowed the Lord to purge the lust from them. They've allowed the Lord to purge the lust out of their lives. Just because a thought comes to you does not mean you have to entertain it. Thoughts come to all of us. It's just a lot of things we're not tempted with anymore. Because God allowed that to be alleviated from us. God will perform surgery on you and you don't even know you're on his table. You won't even remember when you went in the operating room. All you know is, I don't feel like that anymore. I don't think like that anymore. I'm not like that anymore. That does not bother me anymore. Oh, it can happen. But you have to cooperate. You have to let go of some things. You have to be willing to walk away from some people. Because some people are contaminants. Some people are contaminants. Some environments are not good for you. And you keep holding on to people based on your loyalty. And God is saying, get rid of the soul ties. Get rid of the soul ties and let people think what they want to about you. God wants all of you because he wants us to walk in his fullness. He wants us to walk in his fullness, not only in his mercy and grace, but in his power and his authority. You can't keep saying, forgive me. You can finally say, I'm more than a conqueror. You can say, I can do all things. You can live it. You can live it. You can live it. His job is to trap, to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And we have been warned of his tactics. Yet and still, we keep falling for them. God wants you to know today that you can be free from every single thing that binds you. You can be free from every single thing that binds you. There is nothing, and I'm going to repeat that, there is nothing that you have to carry that is not of God. Jesus said, by your faith, you're made whole. By your faith, you're made whole. There's no such thing as I can't help it. There's no such thing. The enemy does not have that much power. You give him power. You give him authority. By your actions, you show him where you are. You say things out of your mouth that you should not say. You behave in a way you should not behave in. And he's sitting back laughing. You're a child of God. And you just said what? Child of God, you just did what? Child of God, and you did. When people walk around talking about how long they've been in prayer, I sit back and watch. Because you don't be in prayer like that, and then you gonna fight somebody. Who are you praying to? I just want to know. Because after a while, you have to understand that God has a standard, and God has a response, and his response is not like the world. So something's missing. Are your prayers seeping out of the canal? It's going to heaven. There is evidence of glory. There is evidence of glory. You have glory. You don't have God's glory, but you have glory. Because he said his credit, he's not giving to anyone. That's what glory is. But you have glory. When you overcome, there's glory. When you persevere, there's glory. When you resist the devil and he flees, there's glory. You have glory. You have victory. You have honor. You have a responsibility to walk in the newness of life. Not be lured by Satan's traps. He knows where he's going, and he's pulling everyone he can with him. We're not going. I said, I'm gonna say it again. I don't think they heard it. We are not going. We're not going with him. You're all gonna make it, and I pronounce that over the audience today. I decree and declare today that everybody sitting here in the name of Jesus will make it to glory. In Jesus' name, you will overcome. Yes, you will. You will stop. You will live in victory. I speak that right now. That's not, I'm not shaking in my bones. I'm telling you, you won't make it. And don't allow the enemy to tell you anything different. This is not a pep talk. I'm telling you, you're going to make it. You are more than conquerors. Do you hear what I'm saying? Do you hear what the word says? You are more than conquerors. And I pray the spirit of fear out of here in the name of Jesus. I rebuke fear right now in the mighty name of Jesus. I cast you out of here right now. You belong to God. You're not wimps. You're not going to say, I'm scared. Next time. No, this time. When it happens to you, this time you're going to resist. You tell your thoughts, be gone in the name of Jesus. You will make it with your husband. Your marriage is going to work. Your kids already behaving. You will not be sick. You will not. Walk in the power and authority that God has given you. Satan's bait is only this, a deceptive trap to hook you into a lifestyle that you think you're stuck in. And you're not. Jesus died to set the captive free. And all you have to do is believe. All you have to do is believe it. Business drinking, not only don't drink it, throw it out. Flush it down the toilet and say, in the name of Jesus, I will never touch this again. I will never call them again. When I feel sad about money, I'm not. too, or you wouldn't be sitting here. We receive too much information that's not ours. Let somebody else be a loser. Let somebody else be broke down. Let us get ourselves together so we can help somebody else. Let us prepare for victory so we can help somebody else. But I'm not walking in defeat. I'm not allowing the enemy to tell me I could if I would. No, I can, so I am. Like Pastor Rachel said, we need to change our language. Talking about I can't do this. I can't celebrate Halloween. No, I don't celebrate Halloween. He has never helped anyone. We don't get it. There's a reason why Jesus died. It took his death to redeem us back to God. And this is going to pass away one day. We're not going to ever meet again. One day this assembly stuff is going to be over. And all of us are going to live somewhere else. And all this is word of pleading to let you know how much power you carry, and you don't have to walk on your feet.
Amen.
Don't allow the enemy to lure you into a false victory until you God understand. He doesn't understand anything but righteousness.
Amen.
Or holiness. And we don't have to do it by ourselves. That's what's so wonderful about it. You've lived a defeated life because you chose to, and it could have been because someone told you or something. Don't even worry about how it happened. You don't have to walk in it any longer. You can get an education. You can be a good father. It's not too late. I don't care what you've done to your kids. Oh, yes. I don't care what you've done. You can get it right. You can take the pride down, the pride of life, and you can ask God, God, give me the words to fix this relationship I broke up.
Amen. Amen.
Give me the words that I need to ask for forgiveness to this person.
Yeah.
Help me fix things with broken relationships that I have so that I can go on and receive the things and prepare myself to receive the things that you have for me. I'm tired of being weak. That I'm tired of being weak. See, we're strong and we're selectively strong. We have areas where we select to be strong in, and then in other areas we're not strong. You choose that because you have the capability to be strong all over, in every area. You can be a conqueror and never miss. There were 700 archers in the Old Testament who hit their target every time and did not miss. Left-handed archers. They hit their target every time. I didn't say close. They hit their target every time. You can beat and win a battle every time the devil comes against you. Every time he tries to lure you with something, you can win every time. You can be undefeated. This is not a pep talk. I said I'm sorry too many times in my life. I'm telling you, I'm going to live like that. When I came to myself, I said, wait a minute. Either the enemy is stronger than God, and I'm believing that the word is a lie, or I'm crazy. And I took the ladder. I said, I must be crazy if I don't believe that. And when I said that, I said, Lord, I want the Holy Ghost to show me. I don't want anyone else. I heard people all my life, and I thank God for them. I had a beautiful father and mother. But I said, you have to be real to me. I saw you be real for them. I saw it all. I've experienced it all. I said, but you know what? Me personally, you got to be real to me. Because I'm the one serving you.
Yeah.
please be real to me. Show me an power that you gave the apostles to say no to Satan. Because I'm not a weak person. I'm sensitive, but I'm not weak. And I got tired of saying I'm sorry. Amen. Do somebody wrong, I'm sorry. Do this, I'm wrong, I'm sorry. I'm to know. When I step back and allow the Holy Ghost with my awful temper and with my awfulness, and I let Him fight my battles, that word became alive. That word became alive. And I'm telling you, you don't have to walk weak. I don't care what anyone does to you. I don't care what anyone does to you. I have forgiven some of the most horrific things that you can possibly do to human beings. Sneaking doing it. And I found out and I forgave. But it wasn't me. It was the Holy Ghost and the Christ in me. And I did not do it and wish they were dead either. I blessed them that cursed me. Because I wanted to see if power could keep me. Because I was tired of keeping myself. There's nothing harder and more challenging than fighting something you can't touch. You can beat up somebody, but you can't fix emotion. Reach it. You can't touch it. You can't. I'm telling you what God can do. Don't fall for the enemy's traps. You are so powerful that He actually sends agents to take you down. And who allowed you to? Because you're weak. As of today, let God rule in your life. Don't let your thoughts, don't let your emotions, it doesn't matter what people do to you. Don't give them that kind of power. If someone's ruined your life, they've ruined it, right? Have they ruined it? Why would you wake up every morning and let them ruin the rest of your existence? And then it looks like you're weak because you forgave them, but you're actually strong.
Yes.
Because you say to them, you ruined my life and I'm not giving you any more power to ruin the rest of my life. People hold this because they think they're doing something for themselves and I would never talk to them and not, wait a minute, you're not that powerful. Now you took a family member, you broke up a whole bunch of stuff. You changed all of our life, and then I'm gonna let you change the way I think and treat me. You got that much power? Oh no, I'm gonna forgive you. I'll feed you, clothe you, do all that, because you can change my life too. And that's what we let people do. We give the enemy so much power that not only does he hurt our feelings and hurt us, we let him change our whole life. And we don't trust people anymore. And we don't love anymore like we should. And then we don't have compassion anymore. And we walk in the enemy's principles and not godly principles because I was hurt. You're not that good. You're not that great. Did you want to change all that? And Jesus died on the cross to erase all that? No, Jesus is greater than you. His blood cleanses all your stuff. All your pain you caused on me, I can cast that care on Him. And I don't have to care. Isn't that beautiful? That's a beautiful thing. The more I don't even have to carry it. Isn't that amazing? But we don't do that. Some of us are stuck in life. As I close. And the Lord told me to say this today. And we honor memories more than we honor Him. God wants that broken today. You lived in the past. You are not your past. I'm going to say that again. You lived in the past. You had a past. You are not your past. And you honor your past so much that it governs your today. And if you live tomorrow, it's going to govern that too. And God wants to go and He said one thing. He said it's an idol. Because you put it before God. You critique everything based on that memory. I don't know who I'm talking to. But everything that you do, everything that you want, everything that you could have, if it does not line up with that memory, you discard it. Or you critique it. And God wants you to stop. He wants to be number one in your life. And the memory is over. Or it will eat you alive. And it will allow you to go to the lake if you don't let God off the memory. God doesn't want our past to be so binding to us that we can't have our present and future. Remember that. Your past is over. Your past is over. Say it to yourself, my past is over. My past is over. Forget it.
Forget it.
Don't accept the devil's bait. Don't bite. It's all lies.